Young Joe started breaking records early on in life. It was a family tradition of sorts. His father held the record for the most days worked without a sick day at Rizzo's garbage disposal. Little Joe, well, he cracked the record for the most papers delivered in a one-year period. I guess you could say this is where his obsessive compulsive behavior started. He'd get on that bike and ride from dawn to dusk. It was on this very paper route he found his first radio.
Hey, Mrs. Sorelli. You think you could take a look at this for me? I need you to get it to work.
Sure, let me have a look.
Information station, Radio 710, WOR.
Yes, sir, life's full of decisions, little guy. Anyway, is that radio of yours? Looks fine now.
What kind of decisions, Mrs. Sorelli?
Joe, like the ones you just made. You know, music versus women. Women versus fun with the guys. Women versus other women. And now you got me started. Luckily, nowadays, all I gotta worry about is the pastrami versus the prosciutto.
Well, why can't you have both?
What do you mean, pastrami and prosciutto? Because they...
No. Why can't you have women and other women and music?
Well, Joe, that's something you're gonna have to learn on your own.
Well, thanks for fixing the radio, Mrs. Sorelli.
No problem, Joe. Oh, congratulations on a new record.
Thanks.
Being from the old country, his dad always tried to teach him to do the right thing. He told him that the guys he idolized were all drug addicts and womanizers, but little Joe would have none of it. All he knew was that they could play guitar. Found out his father was a bit of a musician himself. He was a pretty big folk singer back in the old country, but had to put his dreams aside when he moved here and had to support a family.
Sometimes after work, he'd pull out these old Sultan outfits and put them on over his Dickies work clothes. He'd pull out a poncho blanket and put it on our bed and sit and play guitar. Being a working class schmo never really sat right with him. After all these years, I finally realized he was pretty damn good. I just wish I had a chance to tell him that. It is in his memory that I devoted myself to the appreciation of music.
Attention, attention! It's not time for a movie for a scasso! So get on your feet and then stay to the beat! Yeah! Hey, hey, hey!
New York City is the greatest city in the world and the only city that Joe would ever live in. Where else could he see a concert on the subway on the way to another concert?
No one else can do it. Armageddon is around the corner, my friend.
Armageddon is playing Irving Plaza on the 14th. Here, take this. It sounds like you need it.
Here's a quarter.
Take a ride. 28-year-old unemployed construction worker from Brooklyn, New York, is asking the Guinness Book of World Records to start a new category for most concerts attended in 1 year. Last year, Concert Joe attended 1,031 shows, an average of 3 per night.
Joey's always into music. We bought him a guitar when he was 7, but...
My brother was always taking it so I could never practice. He's a professional musician now. He's taking a lot of concerts. You've seen Frank Sinatra, Buddy Rich, Tony Bennett. You never saw a dead show with me, though.
Yeah, I used to say I'll be grateful when they're dead. I was furious when he missed his high school graduation tour.
Frank Zappa was playing at the Fillmore, and it was closing that week. So I made the decision to go. It was only my second concert, the first time I ever waited on line for a show. I saw the Birds the month before that at Carnegie Hall. It was my first concert. And then I saw the New Eyes at the Purple Sage a week later.
And once we started going into concerts, though, we didn't see very much of him.
Joe's probably the only person that ever took out a student loan. And what he did with it is he bought concert tickets.
In other news, a bizarre chain of events unfolded this evening. There apparently was an altercation between two groups of New York City police officers. One group, apparently in cahoots with this man, assaulted another group of officers. An amateur camera person was able to capture some of the events on a home video camera.
The wife locked him out that night. He wanted to spend the night at Bobby Nez's. The only problem was that Bobby was still out on the road. I've seen some real alcoholics in my day, but this guy takes the cake. He's very precise in his preparation. This guy has a martini glass set between the handlebars of his Harley. He brings all the ingredients, olives, strainer, the whole deal. and he pours himself a martini before every ride. Bobby was a real fixture at the Jones Beach concerts during the summer. This stooge calls himself Yafim. He claims to be an Orthodox rabbi. A little basic research unearthed the real story. He's a con man and a polygamist who ripped off three women in the past year alone. The other members of the crew simply refer to him as the rock and roll rabbi. Even in the mosh pit, he never seems to lose his yarmulke. This wasn't the first time Tommy Lydell had gotten kicked out of a club. Only this time, it happened to be one of the best rock and roll clubs in the city. His rap sheet included 14 counts of drunken driving. It's a miracle he's still alive riding that English racing bike around town in a perpetual drunken stupor. Of course, he knew this rock and roll rabbi character. Here we have Shveta Polotska, an elderly Polish woman who is revered by the other freaks. She's seen more operas than anyone alive. She's also notorious for smelling up the back of the Metropolitan Opera House with her Polish kielbasa she smuggles inside. I'm surprised she doesn't ride around on a Harley, too. His wife locked him out again that night. He wound up at Spike's place.
Hey Joe, how did you come up with the idea for the buzzer?
Well, I never had the incentive to really chase a frisbee, so
used to take a pita bread from Pierre's Falafel on 69th Street, pop a hole through the center, stick a joint through, light it up, throw it back and forth, catch it, take a bite, take a toke. Eventually, I came up with the Busby. You take a Frisbee, put a pipe in the center, you throw it back and forth, goes farther and straighter than any Frisbee in the world. Every time you catch it, you take a toke, the cops come, and you just throw it away.
Who's this guy in the picture anyway? I ain't never seen him before.
That's Vinny the Guinea.
Yeah?
I remember I was riding in a car with him once, and he pulled out a heroin needle and stabbed his mother. Then he tried to kill himself by jumping off the roof.
He wound up breaking both legs. Then he pushes his wheelchair off the roof twice and survives. Finally, the ambulance driver comes up to him and says, Jesus, you again? Don't you know you gotta jump at least 3 stories if you want to kill yourself? He lived on the second floor.
Have fun watching reruns of Murphy Brown.
If you walk out that door, you had better not come back.
Well, I'm going home. Yes, I'm going home. Back to my wife. I'll stay with her the rest of my life. She ain't going around no more. We're going with you.
So he likes to go to a lot of rock concerts. Well, I guess we all have our pet peeves. Tell me, how many did you see last week, or last month, let's say?
I saw over 1,000 last year.
Oh, I see.
And on top of that, get a look at this. He expects me to wear this.
What is that?
It's a bikini and jeans. What else?
I think I was put on this earth to set this record for music.
This is it. This is where everything happened. The miracle happened right here.
The guy finally broke the record tonight. No small feat.
Wake up. Come on, wake up.
Cop or something?
I'm Carson Adler, Guinness Book of World Records, my friend.
We're gonna make you famous.
When the curtain rises on the show, there becomes a whole new reality for Concert Joe.
This guy has seen 8,000 concerts, and he didn't see me at Woodstock.
Yeah, as a critic, I'll usually go to 4 or 5 shows a week, and there's always, Joe's always there in his tie-dye shirt, pipe around his neck, and I've kind of missed that there. It's good to talk to him, but ever since that thing happened with his wife, I haven't seen him around anymore. It's too bad.
I have seen him recently a few times. There may have been a gap prior to the last few times I've seen him and the times before that, but that might be a reflection of me too, because I've been involved in a lot of projects that have kind of kept me out of the scene a bit.
He would just come to my shows about catch the end of the set, like 15, 20 minutes, tell me great, and then he would say something like, this is my 6th show tonight, and I'm gonna catch 2 more before the night is over, you know? So he'd come to Milo Z and get funked up, and then he'd come down to Nightingale's and, you know, catch what was going on over here. You know,
Joe will come in and, you know, watch the band, and, you know, in intervals he'll talk about all the other great shows he saw that night or that week, and it's just, the man is obsessed.
And I always thought it was odd that he would, like, pay to get in and stay for 20 minutes, but then that's because he was rushing off to another show.